warning to the curious. The place on the east coast which the reader is asked to consider is Seabra. It is not very different now from what I remember it to have been when I was a child. Marshes intersected by dikes to the south, recalling the early chapters of Great Expectations. Flat fields to the north merging into heath. Heath, fir woods, and above all, gorse inland. A long seafront and a street. Behind that, a spacious church of flint with a broad, solid western tower and a peal of six bells. How well I remember their sound on a hot Sunday in August, as our party went slowly up the white, dusty slope of road towards them, for the church stands at the top of a short, steep incline. They rang with a flat, clacking sort of sound on those hot days. But when the air was softer, they were mellower too. The railway ran down to its little terminus farther along the same road. There was a gay white windmill just before you came to the station, and another down near the shingle, at the south end of the town, and others on higher ground to the north. There were cottages of bright red brick with slate roofs. But why do I encumber you with these commonplace details? The fact is that they come crowding to the point of the pencil when it begins to write of Seabra. I should like to be sure that I had allowed the right ones to get onto the paper. But I forgot. I have not quite done with the word painting business yet. Walk away from the sea and the town, past the station, and turn up the road on the right. It is a sandy road, parallel with the railway, and if you follow it, it climbs to somewhat higher ground. On your left, you are now going northward, is heath. On your right, the side towards the sea, is a belt of old firs, wind-beaten, thick at the top, with the slope that old seaside trees have. Seen on the skyline from the train, they would tell you in an instant, if you did not know it, that you were approaching a windy coast. Well, at the top of my little hill, a line of these firs strikes out and runs towards the sea, for there is a ridge that goes that way, and the ridge ends in a rather well-defined mound, commanding the level fields of rough grass, and a little knot of fir trees crowns it. And here you may sit on a hot spring day, very well content to look at blue sea, white windmills, red cottages, bright green grass, church tower, and distant Martello Tower on the south. As I have said, I began to know Seabra as a child, but a gap of a good many years separates my early knowledge from that which is more recent. Still, it keeps its place in my affections, and any tales of it that I pick up have an interest for me. One such tale is this. It came to me in a place very remote from Seabra, and quite accidentally, from a man whom I had been able to oblige, enough, in his opinion, to justify his making me his confidant to this extent. "I know all that country, more or less," he said. "I used to go to Seabra pretty regularly for golf in the spring. I generally put up at the Bear with a friend. Henry Long it was, you knew him perhaps." "Slightly," I said. "And we used to take a sitting room and be very happy there. Since he died, I haven't cared to go there. And I don't know that I should anyhow, after the particular thing that happened on our last visit. It was in April we were there, and by some chance we were almost the only people in the hotel. So the ordinary public rooms were practically empty, and we were the more surprised when, after dinner, our sitting room door opened, and a young man put his head in. We were aware of this young man. He was rather a rabbity, anemic subject, light hair and light eyes, but not unpleasing. So when he said, 'I beg your pardon, is this a private room?' we did not growl and say, 'Yes, it is,' but Long said, or I did, no matter which, 'Please come in.' 'Oh, may I?' he said, and seemed relieved. Of course, it was obvious that he wanted company, and as he was a reasonable kind of person, not the sort to bestow his whole family history on you, we urged him to make himself at home. "I dare say you find the other rooms rather bleak," I said. Yes, he did, but it was really too good of us, and so on. That being got over, he made some pretense of reading a book. Long was playing patience, I was writing. It became plain to me after a few minutes that this visitor of ours was in rather a state of fidgets or nerves, which communicated itself to me, and so I put away my writing and turned to at engaging him in talk. After some remarks, which I forget, he became rather confidential. "You'll think it very odd of me," this was the sort of way he began, "but the fact is I've had something of a shock." Well, I recommended a drink of some cheering kind, and we had it. The waiter coming in made an interruption, and I thought our young man seemed very jumpy when the door opened. But after a while he got back to his woes again. There was nobody he knew in the place, and he did happen to know who we both were. It turned out there was some common acquaintance in town, and really he did want a word of advice, if we didn't mind. Of course we both said, "By all means," or "Not at all," and Long put away his cards. And we settled down to hear what his difficulty was. "It began," he said, "more than a week ago, when I bicycled over to Froston, only about 5 or 6 miles, to see the church. I'm very much interested in architecture, and it's got one of those pretty porches with niches and shields. I took a photograph of it, and then an old man who was tidying up in the churchyard came and asked if I'd care to look into the church. I said yes, and he produced a key and let me in. There wasn't much inside, but I told him it was a nice little church and he kept it very clean, but I said, the porch is the best part of it. We were just outside the porch then, and he said, 'Ah, yes, that is a nice porch. And do you know, sir, what's the meaning of that coat of arms there?' It was the one with the three crowns, and though I'm not much of a herald, I was able to say, 'Yes, I thought it was the old arms of the Kingdom of East Anglia.' 'That's right, sir,' he said. 'And do you know the meaning of them three crowns that's on it?' I said I'd no doubt it was known, but I couldn't recollect to have heard it myself. 'Well then,' he said, 'for all you're a scholar, I can tell you something you don't know. Them's the three holy crowns what was buried in the ground nearby the coast to keep the Germans from landing. Ah, I can see you don't believe that. But I tell you, if it hadn't have been for one of them holy crowns being there still, them Germans would have landed here time and again, they would. Landed with their ships and killed man, woman and child in their beds. Now then, that's the truth what I'm telling you, that is. And if you don't believe me, you ask the rector. There he comes, you asked him,' I says." I looked round, and there was the rector, a nice-looking old man, coming up the path. And before I could begin assuring my old man, who was getting quite excited, that I didn't disbelieve him, the rector struck in and said, "What's all this about, John? Good day to you, sir. Have you been looking at our little church?" So then there was a little talk which allowed the old man to calm down, and then the rector asked him again what was the matter. "Oh," he said, "it weren't nothing, only I was telling this gentleman he'd ought to ask you about them holy crowns." "Ah, yes, to be sure," said the rector. "That's a very curious matter, isn't it? But I don't know whether the gentleman is interested in our old stories, eh?" "Oh, we'll be interested fast enough," says the old man. "He'll put his confidence in what you tells him, sir. Why, you know William Ager yourself, father and son, too." Then I put in a word to say how much I should like to hear all about it, and before many minutes I was walking up the village street with the rector, who had one or two words to say to parishioners, and then to the rectory, where he took me into his study. He had made out on the way that I really was capable of taking an intelligent interest in a piece of folklore, and not quite the ordinary tripper. So he was very willing to talk, and it is rather surprising to me that the particular legend he told me has not made its way into print before. His account of it was this. There has always been a belief in these parts in the three holy crowns. The old people say they were buried in different places near the coast to keep off the Danes or the French or the Germans. And they say that one of the three was dug up a long time ago, and another has disappeared by the encroaching of the sea, and one's still left doing its work, keeping off invaders. Well now, if you have read the ordinary guides and histories of this county, you will remember, perhaps, that in 1687 a crown, which was said to be the crown of Redwald, king of the East Angles, was dug up at Rendlesham, and, alas, alas, melted down before it was even properly described or drawn. Well, Rendlesham isn't on the coast, but it isn't so very far inland, and it's on a very important line of access. And I believe that is the crown which the people mean when they say that one has been dug up. And then on the south, you don't want me to tell you where there was a Saxon royal palace which is now under the sea, eh? Well, there was the second crown, I take it. And between these two, they say, lies the third. Do they say where it is? Of course, I asked. He said, yes, indeed they do, but they don't tell, and his manner did not encourage me to put the obvious question. Instead of that, I waited a moment and said, what did the old man mean when he said you knew William Ager, as if that had something to do with the crowns? To be sure, he said, now that's another curious story. Now, these Agers, it's a very old name in these parts, but I can't find that they were ever people of quality or big owners. These Agers say, or said, that their branch of the family were the guardians of the last crown. A certain old Nathaniel Ager was the first one I knew. I was born and brought up quite near here, and he, I believe, camped out at the place during the whole of the War of 1870. William, his son, did the same, I know, during the South African War. And young William, his son, who has only died fairly recently, took lodgings at the cottage nearest the spot, and I've no doubt hastened his end, for he was a consumptive, by exposure and night watching. And he was the last of that branch. It was a dreadful grief to him to think that he was the last, but he could do nothing. The only relations at all near to him were in the colonies. I wrote letters for him to them, imploring them to come over on business very important to the family, but there has been no answer. So the last of the Holy Crowns, if it's there, has no guardian now. That was what the rector told me, and you can fancy how interesting I found it. The only thing I could think of when I left him was how to hit upon the spot where the crown was supposed to be. I wish I'd left it alone. But there was a sort of fate in it, for as I bicycled back past the churchyard wall, my eye caught a fairly new gravestone, and on it was the name of William Ager. Of course, I got off and read it. It said, of this parish, died at Seaborough, aged 28. And there it was, you see. A little judicious questioning in the right place, and I should at least find the cottage nearest the spot. Only I didn't quite know what was the right spot to begin my questioning at. Again there was fate. It took me to the curiosity shop down that way, you know, and I turned over some old books, and if you please, one was a prayer book of 1740-odd in a rather handsome binding. I'll just go and get it. It's in my room. He left us in a state of some surprise. But we had hardly time to exchange any remarks when he was back, panting, and handed us the book opened at the flyleaf, on which was, in a straggly hand, Nathaniel Ager is my name, and England is my nation. Seaborough is my dwelling place, and Christ is my salvation. When I am dead and in my grave and all my bones are rotten, I hope the Lord will think on me when I am quite forgotten. This poem was dated 1754, and there were many more entries of Ager's, Nathaniel, Frederick, William, and so on, ending with the William who had died aged 28. You see, he said, anybody would call it the greatest bit of luck. I did, but I don't now. Of course, I asked the shopman about William Ager, and of course he happened to remember that he lodged in a cottage in the North Field and died there. This was just chalking the road for me. I knew which the cottage must be. There is only one sizable one about there. The next thing was to scrape some sort of acquaintance with the people, and I took a walk that way at once. A dog did the business for me. He made at me so fiercely that they had to run out and beat him off, and then naturally begged my pardon, and we got into talk. I had only to bring up Ager's name and pretend I knew or thought I knew something of him, and then the woman said how sad it was him dying so young, and she was sure it came of him spending the night out of doors in the cold weather. Then I had to say, did he go out on the sea at night? And she said, oh no, it was on the hillock yonder with the trees on it. And there I was. I know something about digging in these barrows. I've opened many of them in the down country. but that was with owner's leave and in broad daylight and with men to help. I had to prospect very carefully here before I put a spade in. I couldn't trench across the mound, and with those old firs growing there, I knew there would be awkward tree roots. Still, the soil was very light and sandy and easy, and there was a rabbit hole or so that might be developed into a sort of tunnel. The going out and coming back at odd hours to the hotel was going to be the awkward part. When I made up my mind about the way to excavate, I told the people that I was called away for a night, and I spent it out there. I made my tunnel. I won't bore you with the details of how I supported it and filled it in when I'd done, but the main thing is that I got the crown. Naturally, we both broke out into exclamations of surprise and interest. I, for one, had long known about the finding of the crown at Rendlesham, and had often lamented its fate. No one has ever seen an Anglo-Saxon crown. At least, no one had. But our man gazed at us with a rueful eye. "Yes," he said. "And the worst of it is, I don't know how to put it back." "Put it back?" we cried out. "Why, my dear sir, you've made one of the most exciting finds ever heard of in this country. Of course it ought to go to the jewel house at the Tower. What's your difficulty? If you're thinking about the owner of the land and treasure trove and all that, we can certainly help you through. Nobody's going to make a fuss about technicalities in a case of this kind." Probably more was said, but all he did was to put his face in his hands and mutter, "I don't know how to put it back." At last Long said, "You'll forgive me, I hope, if I seem impertinent, but are you quite sure you've got it?" I was wanting to ask much the same question myself, for of course the story did seem a lunatic dream when one thought over it. But I hadn't quite dared to say what might hurt the poor young man's feelings. However, he took it quite calmly, really with the calm of despair, you might say. He sat up and said, "Oh yes, there's no doubt of that. I have it here in my room, locked up in my bag. You can come and look at it if you like. I won't offer to bring it here." We were not likely to let the chance slip. We went with him. His room was only a few doors off. The Boots was just collecting shoes in the passage. Or so we thought. Afterwards, we were not sure. Our visitor, his name was Paxton, was in a worse state of shivers than before, and went hurriedly into the room and beckoned us after him, turned on the light and shut the door carefully. Then he unlocked his kit bag and produced a bundle of clean pocket handkerchiefs in which something was wrapped, laid it on the bed, and undid it. I can now say I have seen an actual Anglo-Saxon crown. It was of silver, as the Rendlesham one is always said to have been. It was set with some gems, mostly antique intaglios and cameos, and was of rather plain, almost rough workmanship. In fact, it was like those you see on the coins and in the manuscripts. I found no reason to think it was later than the 9th century. I was intensely interested, of course, and I wanted to turn it over in my hands, but Paxton prevented me. "Don't you touch it," he said. "I'll do that." And with a sigh that was, I declare to you, dreadful to hear, he took it up and turned it about so that we could see every part of it. "Seen enough," he said at last, and we nodded. He wrapped it up and locked it in his bag and stood looking at us dumbly. "Come back to our room," Long said, "and tell us what the trouble is." He thanked us and said, "Will you go first and see if the coast is clear?" That wasn't very intelligible, for our proceedings hadn't been, after all, very suspicious, and the hotel, as I said, was practically empty. However, we were beginning to have inklings of we didn't know what, and anyhow nerves are infectious. So we did go, first peering out as we opened the door, and fancying, I found we both had the fancy, that a shadow, or more than a shadow, but it made no sound, passed from before us to one side as we came out into the passage. "It's all right," we whispered to Paxton. Whispering seemed the proper tone. and we went with him between us back to our sitting room. I was preparing, when we got there, to be ecstatic about the unique interest of what we had seen. But when I looked at Paxton, I saw that would be terribly out of place, and I left it to him to begin. "What is to be done?" was his opening. Long thought it right, as he explained to me afterwards, to be obtuse, and said, "Why not find out who the owner of the land is and inform—" "Oh, no, no," Paxton broke in impatiently. "I beg your pardon, you've been very kind. But don't you see, it's got to go back. And I daren't be there at night, and daytime's impossible. Perhaps, though, you don't see. Well, then, the truth is that I've never been alone since I touched it." I was beginning some fairly stupid comment, but Long caught my eye and I stopped. Long said, "I think I do see, perhaps. But wouldn't it be a relief to tell us a little more clearly what the situation is?"